Great to be back here. It's Tuesday today, the 25th of June 2019. Happy birthday to my junior. My junior's birthday is today. Unfortunately, last night he went to play football and he got himself into trouble. So right now, he's struggling with that pain. So no birthday celebration. But say, Prince, happy birthday to you. I hope you get away, especially when you sprain to your leg. It's not easy at the ankle there. It's troubling, but I hope you're gonna get away. Happy birthday to you. Right. At our show today, the Max Kato Show, we'll be playing host to one of Liberia's funniest songs as well. I think you're already in the house. Let's see whether we can go to the dashboard already. No. We have a special guest here, so I'm not taking any other person. Just looking for him. I can see Mr. Dempster. Trying to reach our guest.
We cannot let it go.
you see, let's stop the music there. We find it difficult to get our studio guest, Mr. Adama Kiatamba. Okay, let's see. I think we're seeing some sign here now that he will be with us soon. Let's hope the technology will work so we can take our guest. Once again, we do sincerely apologize because we're at least 30, 35 minutes later. It was due to some technical problems we're facing in the studio. But it's always better late than never, and say good afternoon, wonderful afternoon from my end. And we're hoping to have a great discussion here, especially to have Mr. Adama Kiatamba Dempster here, who is a campaigner for social justice in Liberia, and leading this quest for the establishment of war and economic crimes code, economic crimes code in Liberia, and of course the full implementation of the TRC. So it will be a great opportunity to have him on here. So we're trying now, we just place a call to him, and no answer from live video guest. Why? So I'm gonna try again and see. All right, they say no answer from live video guest. I don't know why. Mr. Dempster, if you can place the call, I try from my end, it's not, it just dropped right now. But those of you watching, if you don't mind, if you can share the video, invite somebody as well to come. Let's talk about Mama Liberia coming here. Some stories here as well. Because there are reasons why Mr. Dempster actually decided to take the lead in championing and pushing for the establishment of war and economic crime school for Liberia. Yes, there are reasons behind it, and we want to know. So it's a pleasure, first of all, for him to have accepted our invitation. Let's go back again on the dashboard and see if we can send him a request again. Okay. Press is going. So long, we've seen adding there. Facebook is adding. Well, that's a sign. The next thing, by the time we see connecting, then he's coming on live. So our request is already to you, if you can just accept it there. We'll definitely have you on. Just to let you know as well, there's a developing story in Liberia. Somewhere.
Hello?
Wow.
Hello.
It's great to see you, Mr.
I'm sorry, I'm not in office. I ran out of office. And I thought I could get in office before the interview. So as you see, I'm staying in my car. I'm driving. There's a huge traffic that caught me.
Right. Is it safe for you to be talking to us while driving? If not, we can wait for you.
I'm not driving. I pull over just to talk because I didn't want to waste this time.
Okay. All right, let's hope we will have a good connection as well as it starts already. So it's a pleasure having you on. Thanks for giving us your time this afternoon.
Yeah, okay. I also noticed that maybe my video may not be too clear like yours. I don't know.
Yeah, we're coming in, fading in and out. So I think it's okay if we can hear your voice. The photo itself coming in, fading in and out. So I don't think that would be a big problem so long we can hear you.
Okay. But then I'm so sorry for the inconvenience, but I think it's good for us to discuss, please.
No, not at all. No, it's not. I mean, so long you have your time to give us 10, 15, 20 minutes, that's great. There's nothing about inconvenience from our end. And we do also sorry that we came out late as well due to some technical problem that you knew of. Anyway, let's keep the ball rolling because of time as well. First of all, we a lot of Liberian people are already tuning in already and people coming on and saying, but Let's get to know Mr. Dempster. I mean, we're hearing you, we see in the media, we see people posting your picture all over, and you're here and there having restless time running after the establishment of war and economic crimes code, and to bring a perpetrator of the civil war to book. But let's get to know you, since you are on our platform today.
Well, again, let me use this opportunity to say hi and say a big thank you to you, Max, for the level of work you've done over the time and continue to do. Adama Dempster is just a native Liberian guy, a native Liberian boy, parents from Grand Cape Mount County, but my parents did settle in Nima County, that was in Yekipa, where I was born, and I had my early childhood. And when the Civil War started in 1989, my family had to move back to Monrovia, where we relocated back to Monrovia. But again, the war came running after us, and the war caught up with us in Monrovia. So it became more devastating for us. But to just give you a little background of my family, like I said, we hail from Cape Mount. And I have my early childhood school in Yekipa, and later moved to Monrovia and continued high school, and then went to university. I got a background in sociology and political science, and then extended my professional career into human rights, with a background in human rights and international humanitarian law. And I had opportunity to have gone to prestigious institutions like the United States Institute of Peace, where I am a fellow. I also had the opportunity to have done a standard course with the International Center for Transitional Justice and the New York University, with background in transitional justice. But you also expect me to know that I've come a human rights professional. This is my life. This is the professional career I have earned for more than 15 years now. So this is the era I fit. I work on human rights issues, direct human rights issues. Transitional justice is part of human rights issues. So when you see us communicating, talking about war crimes today, reparation for victims, they are all packaged within the transitional justice course. So this is how you have found us advocating for war crimes code, accountability for past crime, of course, redress for victims of the civil war, reconciliation that will renew Liberia and restore Liberia lost hope. These are important things that will continue to advance in our advocacy on a daily basis.
Wow. Great. Wonderful CV, and thanks so much for everything you put in as well. Thanks to the wonderful parents that also gave you that support. We appreciate you. It's great to have a wonderful son like you, who is actually now giving back to your country as a whole. It's a pleasure to have you on today. But let me first of all start by asking you, I mean, in terms of your upbringing, sitting in the middle, coming from Nimba and having background in Cape Mount County. How was it like, I mean, in terms of your upbringing in your house? How was it? Was it a kind of a disciplinary house, a home, or it was kind of a relaxed, giving you guys chance, whatever you want to do?
Well, those who know Adama Dempster, they can practically tell you, I'm a non-violent person. The home we grew up in, we respect the elderly, we respect older people, and we also respect the manners. So, and you do not take the law into your hands. In your mind, maybe angry and be annoyed by somebody, you have to lodge complaint, where the parents will have to investigate to have an amicable way of resolving such matter. But like you said, my parents were people who love family. By good background in family, help people and help other people in communities, and in that lifestyle, I mean, we grew up in that kind of manner where we have not had the opportunity to be violent in any form. So, in Nima County, where my parents settled, because my parents, they left from Cape Mount and moved to the concession community. Nima County was a concession community where you had Lanco. And Lanco was one area that employment was very huge. They were employing people, having people coming from diverse places or locations in Liberia that were going to the concession community to work. So my parents moved up into Nima and where they settled and hired us. So our family have a great investment in Nima County, and moving forward, those investments, they are stayed there. And I think it was much peaceful because they moved in Nima to work, to earn living, build family, and those are things that helped already give us a better start of life as a family. So in the community where we live, under no circumstances or condition that we were seen as troublemakers, no. We were peaceful people, and our parents always kept that difficult peace quiet, that orderliness within the family domain, that we do not turn into violence, we don't turn into getting things on our own, but rather we rely on the family to help when it comes to advancing, when it comes to having the desire to advance our life. Those are things that we're taught to do. So it's one step at a time. You do not go rushing, you do not go crushing, but you want to make sure that one step at a time, you have your goals, you have your aims, and these are things to push for. So based on purpose, based on the desire to be contributing positively for life and life over, both for individual and community level work, these are areas that will make investment because of the kind of background we had.
Well, okay. Did you witness prior to the war, 1989 war? Do you remember anything in terms of how? Let's say Kiman County or where you came from, your other connection in Nima County. In terms of bringing people together, how was it being done like? Because we were somehow astonished when the war came and we saw the difference. I mean, before then, Grangida and Nima County were kind of very close people, but then time came, they went far apart or so. Prior to that time, how was it like? Did you witness anything as a child growing up or as a young person?
Well, what really happened is that I may not be able to give you an in-depth reflection of the bad blood. I will call it bad blood that spell out between the people of Nima and Grangidan. But what I did remember that we had good number of people from Grangidan living in Yekepa, living in Nima. And these were people who were living freely. They were not people who were at local head or people who had some level of indifferences that we did not see. Because I remember where you had the mining community, that is Bapa. Bapa, that is Sanikule man, around Sanikule, which is the capital city of Nima County. The suburb of Sanikule, it flows down to the mining sector. During the mining sector, you had some crown people or people from Grangida living in those big towns. And they were doing their normal work. Some people were involved in farming. Some people were involved in mining activities. There was this level of peace. There was this level of uniqueness and togetherness that existed. Do you understand? But what I remember in my little man knowledge is that during the Nima Ray, that was in the 80s, you know, you remember they had Nima Ray 1, 2, 3. And the like of Char Julu, from what we heard, that his family were being raped and killed, brutally killed, and things started to slip out of the way. But I remember as a little man, or a little boy, President Doe, Samuel Doe used to go to Yekepa for weekend. Samuel Doe used to go to Yekepa on an occasional basis for weekend. And at the time, you had Charles Doe serving as the PPF. That was the Plan Protection, force that they had that was responsible for security. Was basically head of that Denver Security Division. And he was a very popular guy in Yekepa, Charles Julu. So Doe too from Grangida and Charles Julu from Grangida, Doe always used to go to Yekepa to visit Charles Julu and all our friends. And Yekepa was a beautiful place and everyone wanted to live in Yekepa. So you could find out that there was not anything like a bad blood There was not anything like a bad blood that was really sparing out between the people of Nima and Grenjia. But it was just as a result of the first Nima raid that broke into, you know, the first attack. And then it started to grow up. The attack started between the people of Grenjia and Nima County. From my little man experience and remembrance, these are things that I did, you know, vividly hear and observe in my little man way of looking at this.
Now, Demsa, before we come to the big question of the day, you know, as to what actually led you into this advocacy thing, especially running after the establishment of war and economic crime school, which you're spending, you know, you're spending your money, you're spending time, you're spending a lot of energy into it. Before we come to that, 1989, I mean, let me start from 1989. That's the period I saw. I mean, I was alive and I saw you as a young boy. Let me forget about where the TRC started from 1979. But in terms of your recollection and your experience, where were you during the period of 1989 to 2013?
Okay, so when we talk about 1989, I was still in Yekebat. I was in Yekebat and in school with good number of Nimbadian. That was a high classmate who were Gil and Manon, Mandingos, and the rest of different tribes. So in Yekebat, which was a very good environment, the mining sector, life was good. You have running water, you have electricity, and you have family had good incomes. So there was not a much of burden when it comes to family life. And so Yekebat being the place that we stay over and over, and you had the military, that was the AFL, had a very strong base in Yekebat. And through our school life, it was just out of, you know, a sudden situation that we heard that there were some people at the border of Ivory Coast that were bringing war. That was 1989. So the rumors started between either October 1989, going down to November, before December, the attack started. So what has happened? We heard that, yeah, there are people who they're about to come out of a war. There was this rumor just coming in that people were trying to enter Liberia some other way. But later, of course, December, the war was launched from the border of Africa's. Then it closed the spread. And the paper now being a very good environment, good community, fear started to hit. But initially, people were not taking that to be a real serious issue, because we have not seen war, we have not fought war. So people did not take the issue of war to be so serious. But as day went by, there was report coming always that the military had gone in and there were a group of them being killed. And the rebels were hitting from town to town. They were damming, invading from one town to another town. And the news was just growing. The news was growing. And then it became more heavy when we saw a huge deployment of AFL soldiers during that have spread up to almost 1990 now. Because from December, right in between early January 1990, there was a huge deployment of military people into Nima County. And most of them were actually staying around Yekepa, between Yekepa, Sanikole, that is the highway they were using those areas. And they were always going on the front. But interestingly, before the rebel war was actually launched, there were recruitments, secret recruitment being carried out. And I remember most of my classmates, two guys who were like, Pierre, I could not see most of them in our community anymore. One time when I looked, the guys have come after a couple of months. They have come back into the community, but with different features. They were more not of the same kind of young guys we were like, but they were the with a different feature. Apparently, they have been recruited as child soldiers. They are going through some level of orientation, and they were not just the normal kids that you remember. So my old man was very fast. I noticed that, where have these guys come from? So we thought that normally when school closed in December, the kids will go on the farm, they will go to their villages, and then later on they come back. But this time, not that they went to their villages, because we ourselves had orange plantation. We had diamond mine. So on weekends, my old man and myself, we will go to the diamond mine or go to the orange plantation, spend a week before coming back to Yekepa. But in the case of these guys, it was totally different. But they were recruited now as child soldiers, and they came back to also serve as an influence to get other guys to go back with them to be recruited as well. So I was one of the guys who was a target for them, because in our community, I was active, and I was almost like playing leadership role. So they were trying to use that means. But my old man had noticed them, and then too, they said, no, the way you guys are like, I don't like how they look, so I don't want you going out with them. So he restricted my movement and would not allow me to go, or it was just God that hired him to have actually identified this. So only to know later on, when the war started to expand, I got to know that these guys were not recruited. They started carrying burrito. That is, the war has spread out, things have gone out of control. And the only thing my old man remember was that he needed to move me from Yekepat back to Morovia. So before moving me from Yekepat to Morovia, we have had curfew, because the war had extended into a deeper part of Nima. So there was curfew imposed. The curfew normally was not normal 5 or 6 or 6. It was from 4 o'clock to 7 o'clock the next morning. So the curfew was not a normal curfew that would say, oh, you will find sun will be shining, daylight is so bright, but we are indoor, because the military were actually mapping and moving from community to community in Yekepa. So this became very much strange, horrible, fear had engulfed. People started to move into Guinea. People started to move Africa's using all our means. So other people were trying to get to move here, but it was not easy risks. But what happened is that my old man managed to have got me connected with one of his very good friends who was influential. He informed the guys to bring me down to Morovia. So it was this older man who brought me to Morovia. But even on our way to Morovia, that was between March of 1990. It was terrible. Because as you move on along the way, you could see a truck full of dead military personnel. Military personnel with blood draining down the truck, the military truck, and they are carrying the body down to Bolivia. So with tarpaulin, and sometimes they park the traffic, it was so horrible and fearful for a young man like me. So as God will have it, I let the people arrive in Bolivia, and that's how things got a little bit relief for me. And then onward, I started to go up. My mom was in Cape Mount. She came back from Cape Mount and then collected me and carried me to Cape Mount for like 2 months. So you find out before the war came to Morovia, I had a time between to have at least adjusted myself before the war came back to Morovia.
Wow, that's our memories. In terms of direct effect on the war, let's forget about the collective as a nation. Did you lose anybody so dearest to you?
I remembered, it may not be a direct family member, but I remember very close neighbors, people that I knew very closely, you know, that were killed during the Civil War. You understand it? And some people that I also knew sustained bullet. But in the course of that, they bled profusely and died later on. So, but in terms of directly, I did not remember any member of my family that were arrested and killed point blank. No, I did not remember anything of such. But what I remember, at a certain point of time, as we were traveling, the rebels will arrest us, detain us for hours, and later on release us. But sometimes they were even stop us looking for Mandingo people, and then when they found, either they found Mandingo person or not, but of course killing was just ongoing. As you guys moved to a different location, there was this aspect of killing was just being carried on a different location. Either they just suspect somebody, accuse them of being crown, accuse them of being Mandingo, they would kill you. These are things that I remember vividly.
Ankema County was another county that was very, very highly hit. And I think as we speak, they do have mass graves there, if not one. Have you been back home to see those mass graves?
Well, what I do know and I remember, I never had a year long time in Grand Cape Mount County. I did not really live in Grand Cape Mount County. If I remember vividly, I spent not more than three months in Grand Cape Mount County with my mother. But I spent all of my time outside of Grand Cape Mount County. But if you go back to the threshold that the TRC, that is captured in the TRC report, Grand Cape Mount County is the third county that have the largest massacres that took place. So if you want to calculate, they have pretty close to 24 massacres that took place in Grand Cape Mount. Then the Dal of Lofa, which is the higher Lofa, had 32 massacres. Riverside being the second, Riverside had 30 massacres. And Bakulu had 18 massacres, according to the TRC report. Those are the four counties that had the highest number of massacres during the entire civil wars of Liberia. Of course, they did. Those atrocities were committed by different warring factions within the Liberian, conflict arena.
Now, in terms of your involvement, but before we come to that, I want you to make us to understand your own specialization, which has to do with transitional justice. Thank God that you are qualified in that area, and you're now seated in the proper seat that you need to put your skills and your knowledge to work. What is it if people talk about transitional justice? It is in the TRC as well. If they talk about transitional justice, for a layman like me, I don't know anything about it. What is it?
Transitional.
Oh, we just lost. We just lost him. I think somebody tried to call him on his line. So normally, it does happen because if you're online. How do you call the other one? IMO, it will kick you out completely. It can be so annoying, especially when you are on discussion like this, or you are on some kind of mostly it happens when you are on live. It can just kick you out automatically, and I don't know, it's not really, really good. But you can't do anything about it, because the person who is calling you, they have no idea if you are on live or not. But yet, our studio guest on the Max K Talk Show this afternoon is Mr. Adama Katamba Dempster. He's a strong advocate, campaigner for social justice in Liberia. He's one of those actually pushing the bandwagon for the establishment of war and economic crime school for Liberia. And of course, the full implementation of the TRC. We have it on today. For us to hear from him reasons why he have decided to actually invest almost everything into this quest. And so we just lost him a little bit. I think it's due to some kind of call that just came in and actually took him out. All right, so let me throw in a short music. Ongoing development in Liberia at Kingsville, that's somewhere in Magibi County. Reports that are coming from there are not encouraging at all. And Justice Forum Liberia, we're continuing to caution our people and also caution the government in terms of dealing with the situation and handling it with extra care. We're calling our citizens as well to perhaps use other means instead of blocking roads. We understand you want to create an avenue where states to come to your attention. We're also in sympathy with the entire community there for the loss as well. Two children or two young people. Allegedly, their bodies were found and body parts taken away. We're in sympathy with you. Justice Forum Liberia is in sympathy with you, the entire community there. We're hoping that the situation will be put under control soon. But yes, as you say, you are as you sit right here now watching the program, the Max K Talk Show. Our special studio guest is Mr. Adama Dempster Ketama. Let's see whether we can get him. Let's send in a request and see whether we can. These things are happening anyway. Sometimes you're on some kind of call, just come in and kick you out completely. And when I'm on like that, and it happened to me, I can say, wow. I don't know. It's like, I can be angry. Don't, you know, let me admit to you. But you can't do anything anyway. So let's see whether we can get Mr. Dempster back as we continue on this beautiful, beautiful Tuesday discussions here. So I'm Mama Liberia. My lines are open as well, just in case if you want to call and add say a few words to Mr. Dempster, or you want to ask him questions as well, you can call in. Okay, so let's see how call is going through now. Let's see how call is going through. Okay, we just dropped again. Let's try again and place this call to Mr. Dempster. See, we understand anyway, he's not actually in his own comfort zone, so let's hope the network from where he is will be able to permit us to continue with this show. But it's a Max K Talk Show here, and we are indeed broadcasting to you from the United Kingdom on this special edition of the Max K Talk Show. Mr. Adama Ketama Kempina for Social Justice is our guest. He's one of those that actually driving the wheels, who is the captain of the ship that we are on, and seeking for justice for 250,000 people, 250,000 of our citizens. Majority of them were kids. Majority of them were even in the stomach of their moms. All right, we lost him again. Let's see. Probably something else is going on. All right, but let me throw this song.
Hello, right, guys.
Wow, yeah.
What?
Yeah, you're back.
I'm actually coming to the UK before the by the 7th of July.
Wow, okay.
You got me?
I'm sure.
Yeah. Because my network here is terrible. I'm actually coming to the UK the 7th of July. If it is possible that I can appear live, that we can work on, but I'll be in the UK the latest on the 7th of July.
No, that one part, we'll sit down. Even after this show, when you come, definitely we'll sit down one-on-one live on the coffee table and while we're having our discussion.
Yeah, so that's
all right. So getting serious anyway, because the network is really getting bad. I think you're driving now, so we're not.
Yeah, it's ugly. So I had to move from where I am, but let me, how you call it? It's not anything, but just if it's just so difficult. I didn't want it to happen. Okay.
All right, you know what? You pay attention.
No. Are you getting me?
I'm gonna be on the show. We're getting you, boy, fading in. So what we're gonna do? You drop safe and reach. If you have time, you can call in. If not time, then we can reschedule you.
Yeah, I will have to reschedule because I really want us. It's important because right now we have a big conference that is coming up. We have a legislative conference that is coming up on war crimes court, and we also intend to have an activities with the Liberian Bar Association on the finalization of the war crimes court bill, the bill to establish a war crimes court. All these are all important issues that I wish to give a spotlight to this show so that you'll be on top of issue. But more will be ruled out when I'm in the UK on the 7th.
All right, no problem, Demsa. Let's give you time so you can drive safely and you pay attention to, because we really want you. We want you to continue to live on until we can see this thing coming through. So thank you very much for the short time. I just want to go into the TRC to share with our people that are following.
No problem. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry for the
inconvenience. All right, that's Mr. Adam Dempster there. We do sincerely apologize. Indeed, like you said, we'll find time when you come to the UK. But we'll sit down somewhere that you will be able to see all the both of us live together here in the United Kingdom. But so, nothing spoiled in terms of advocacy. What I'm going to do now is to go into the TRC and pass some information to you for some of you that haven't read the TRC. The one I'm reading, the copy I have with me in my library already, is the one that is unedited. Unedited by the commissioners. And so I think words by words as it was documented. So let me go quickly. Let me take you to recommendations on accountability. Extraordinary Criminal Tribunal. That's section 12.0 and 12.1 say accountability. Extraordinary Criminal Tribunal for Liberia. The TRC hereby recommends the establishment of an extraordinary criminal tribunal for Liberia to try all persons recommended by the TRC for the commission of human rights violations, including violations of international humanitarian law, international human rights law, war crimes and economic crimes, including but not limited to killing, gang rape, multiple rape, forced recruitment, sexual slavery, forced labor, exposure to deprivation, missing, etc. Now, this is it. This is a recommendation here. You know when you hear somebody like Prince Johnson referring to the TRC as a trash, when you don't hear any word from the current president of Liberia, when she was hesitant to talk about the TRC, these are some of the reasons. When today Mr. Josh Weah is speechless, when he's pretending that he doesn't know anything about what took place in Liberia between 1979 and 2003, when this man is doing this as the son of Liberia, somebody who said and who told the people, and the people were convinced that indeed he so much loved this country, when he is keeping silent on this important document, there are many questions to ask. When the madam was in power and people tried to approach her on the issue of the TRC, and she was dodging it, there are reasons behind it. When you see people, sons and daughters, yearning and crying out for justice for the 250,000 lives that we lost. There are reasons behind it. When you see some of us, we have sleepless night, and every time and then we are engaging our authorities. Every time and then we are engaging the international community, international organizations to help us. There are reasons behind it. And I remember vividly this body, the TRC, the commissioners for the TRC were not just, they didn't just wake up from bed in the morning and say, we're going to set up this. You can wake up anytime in the morning and you set up a think tank organization, an advocacy organization. You can wake up anytime in the morning to say, well, today, from today on, I want to be advocating for women's rights. Yes, you can wake up this morning, or you can wake up at any time and say, from today, I will champion the cause that persons with disability should be given the same right as person who is physically fit. Yes, you have all right to do that. And you can go ahead. And nobody will ask you a question. But you can't wake up early in the morning and say, I am the chairperson of the TRC. And I am going to call some people. We do it. We put this work together and document it and make our recommendation. No, you can't. It's a body that's supposed to be put together by the government, empowered by the people, and give them the logistical needs. It's the work that people are actually vetted. It's a responsibility that you have to choose carefully as to who should be on such a commission. And that's exactly what we did when it was recommended at the Akosumbo Accord in Ghana, before we had a lasting peace, maybe a peace. That's why I pushed the madam, despite the fact she knew very, very well that her name is mentioned, or her name is inside, good, when it comes to prosecuting anybody who brought war into our nation. Despite the fact that she knew about it, there was tension behind her. Before the commission was established, the international community, including ECOWAS, were behind her. That before you came to power, we met in Accra, Ghana, and the Akosumbo Accord. And this is what Liberians, and this is what the international community, when they all came together, including those mad people that brought the war onto Liberia, this is what they agree on, that you should establish the process leading to a lasting peace in Liberia. And that is by commissioning the TRC body, the Truth and Reconciliation. Yes, she was mandated, she was pushed, and she was threatening as well. If you don't do it, we're not going to support you. You have to do this. And that's how the madam went to work. She did it on a duress. Let me make it plain to you. She did it on a duress. Because you know definitely, we still remember those words, bring down the mansion. We will rebuild it. Mr. Charles Taylor, if it costs you to bring that, to bring the mansion down, the executive mansion down, bring it down. We will rebuild it after a while. That's a destructive word. These are all destructive words. And so she knew very, very well that if she have rushed, and there was no way that she could even rush on her own to establish the TRC, but no way. There was no way she could do that. She couldn't do it. But I told her, I said, you have to do it. If you don't do it, we are not going to support you. If you don't do it, we are going to sit back and give our support to other countries. we're going to give more support to Sierra Leone. And so she was put on the jurors and say, okay, but then let me just do it for doing sake. Let me just do it for doing sake. And she appointed Councilor Jerome Voidea and the rest of the people and gave them the mandate together with us, because the tax money is the one that was spent, and give the people the mandate and say, go and talk to your people, meet them, document everything. What happened, what they heard, what they saw, their participation and everything, let them come forward and say it. From 1979 to 2003, we want you to document everything. Go anywhere, go as far as wherever you can go and meet your Liberian people and hear from them. And come back and give us your report. And that's what happened. And they went to work. Majority of them are people with law background. And they have one or two degrees in law, specialization in law. And these are the people that were actually good for the work. And the composition included civil servants and civilians and citizens of the Republic of Liberia. That's what we did. Together with the madam, we give the mandate to the TRC body, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission body. We give them the mandate. We supported them. And they went to work and put this document together. Then somebody is sitting there and telling us that the document is trash. It's trash. Those words hurt me when I hear somebody using those words. Those words hurt me when I think about the 250,000 people that we lost. I mean, innocent people. A child in the stomach of their mother. You have the gut to come and take the life of that mother. You have the gut to kill that child. And today you're sitting here. Say you don't want the TRC to you don't want any recommendation from the TRC to take place. You don't even want the establishment of war and economic crimes code for Liberia. Then who are you? What are you? Shameless people. Devilish people. Sometimes I say I don't blame you. Some of you guys that are giving those utterances, we don't blame you. I personally don't blame you. I blame those that are in power. Yes, President Weah, especially so. We can't talk about Ma Al Erling, because in her case, she couldn't do it. She couldn't make sure that a TRC is implemented, because she should have been number one on the list as well. But you, Mr. Weah, you're surprising us. And I am deeply, 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 deeply in regret. I am. That's about the fact I never supported you coming to power also. But these are some of the things some of us were afraid of. We want somebody who can make a sound decision, who will be brave to make a decision, who will be brave to say things, who will be brave to say, this is what I mean. And say it publicly and do it. For you to come to power and we're crying, your people are crying. The dead souls, their souls are running around in Liberia, still looking for peace. And we're sitting there, our leaders sitting there celebrating. Up to now, shamefully, up to now, we can't even have a park somewhere around the country, somewhere. In Masurado County, we can have a plaque to say this is the plaque representing the 250,000 people that we lost. Whenever you feel lonely and you miss your family, come and sit under the plaque. We can have it like a park that people can go there and sit there and reflect. People can go there and sit there and think about their people. Yes, that's what I want to see in Liberia. Let's have this place. Let's have a park exclusively for them. You can't remember all their names. We don't know all of them. We can't do it like the 9/11. Right now, you go to the USA, you meet a plaque there. Names are there. Over 300 people, their names are there. We can't do that. But we can have a plaque, a representation of these people, of those souls. We can build a park that we can live. Anybody can live from anywhere when they go home to go visit. They can go to that park and go and sit down and do a super reflection and mourn their people. But all of this cannot come to an end if we don't have this establishment, if we don't bring perpetrators to justice. We are doing injustice to this, to the dead souls. How many years since after the Ebola virus? I have been calling, I have been writing personally, I've been engaging members of the house since 2015. Let us have a memorial for all of those that we lost during the Ebola. We can have it. We have foreign doctors. We have foreign healthcare workers that came from different parts of the world. They went and died there in Liberia. We have our healthcare workers. We have volunteers. A good number of our citizens, civilians, children, pregnant women, they died. These are records we're able to get as a state. We're able to get this record. Within 6 months now, we can get all of those names. Have a plaque somewhere. Establish a park somewhere for them. So that we can remember all of them. And always go there and pay the respect to them. Some of them majority of the people were buried in mass grave during the Ebola. Shamefully, yes, they were. Instead, still we're sitting down to sitting here that people doesn't even know why they are on this planet Earth. Shame, man. That our leaders, they don't even know their purpose on this planet Earth. And they call themselves leaders. How much, if one person can take home $40,000 to $50,000 or more a month or so, what can we sacrifice, man? And bring dignity to these people. Some of them, like I said, some of them were foreigners. Medical personnel. They die in our land. If we have this plaque, if we have their park, and we get their names and we put them among the names of our citizens. Their people can even leave from their countries. They can leave from wherever they are. They can come to Liberia and go there and go pay their respect to that plaque and sit in that park and remember them. I've written a letter. I've engaged some of them one-on-one, so-called lawmakers. And nobody care. What kind of a human being are we? And every day we just selfish, and just seeking our own interest. It can be very, very difficult to find a selfless human being in Liberia who is so selfless. Selfishness, greed, power seeking, corrupt attitudes. It's all embedded in us. Unfortunately, it's a land that is referred to as a land of liberty, land of freedom. What a shame. And today, after spending all of the money, almost 3 years, these people were documenting the TRC. Somebody is telling me that that is a trash, we should throw it in the sea. When I met Prince Johnson the last time and I had an interview with him, he repeated that to me, face to face. They said the TRC should be thrown in the water. It should be thrown into the sea. Come on, man. For God's sake? I mean, so the life of one person is important than the 250,000 people? Mr. Weah, wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Quite frankly, you're nowadays worse. Very divisive. You gotta think, Mr. Weah. Even when I think you served as captain before for your teams or so. You can't get on that football field as a team you're playing and see your players perhaps misbehaving or expressing anger because of some other decision against them. And then you go and join them and start doing the same old thing. You can't do that. The reason you are captain for either the captain for the team or the captain for that day, the reason they give you that responsibility, the team manager feels that you will be able to handle things in a cordial manner. That's why they will give you that ban. They don't see, I mean, you can't be a rude person, somebody who doesn't accept defeat. Somebody who's quick to act with anger or react aggressively. You can't be in that category. The team manager will make you a captain of the day. I'm not even talking about captain for the whole team. They want somebody who is responsible. Now, for example, in the case of the game between Cameroon and England, we have seen a lot of football games that sometimes when you look at it, when you see the decision and you see the reaction of the players and the reaction of the referee, the reaction of the team managers and things, sometimes you wonder, why are we playing football then? Now, the captain of this gone game between England and Cameroon, if that captain was behaving the same way or have behaved the same way other players were behaving, that whole team, they're going to find it. I don't even know whether they will stay, you know, face some kind of problem with FIFA. And so you as a leader, Mr. President, you should be the last person to even use words that are unacceptable. Last time you came, you told us, you advanced strongly, that there will be no street or citizen will walk into in Liberia easily if they insult you or if they say something that you feel insulted. That's what you just said the last time. Now, people are your supporters want to kill other people just because they are linking you with corruption in Liberia. You go on social media, you refer to Mr. George Weah as a rogue, as a thief. Also, somebody want to even pass through the computer to come and hack you up and chop your head off. That's going on in our society. It is happening on the soil in Liberia. That the moment you say a few words, the moment you say a word, that they feel that it is insulting to the president, they will come at you. Now, Mr. President, isn't you that's supposed to be the last person, not even the last to say anything of that such? You are the one that's supposed to diffuse the tension. Because you hear everything that goes on in this amongst Liberians in this, let's say whether on social media or on the ground in Liberia, you hear it. That one, you when you came to Paris the last time, you told us, you followed it. By the time we all shows that these people that are near you, when they know that we're talking about your government, we're talking about you, they put it on and they carry close to you. You're saying that you watch us. For us, for me, I know that personally. I know that one. That most of my shows, you watch them. I will never sit on the platform here and insult you or insult anybody. My upbringing was not like that. I respect everybody. But Mr. President, you have to take the lead. If you want to unite this nation, you shouldn't be the one to be the first to either throw words at people. No matter how bitter you are in your heart with them, do not voice it out. You can sit among your colleagues, you can sit among your boys or so, and you talk and you advance your anger right there, and you'll be finished with it. Do not get on the media. Do not get on the radio. Do not go somewhere and use a platform and throw words. You are harming the nation. You are harming the nation. I know how fragile people are. I know how people are so bitter in Liberia in terms of either those are supporting you and those that are against you. Whether it's on a personal level or on a professional level, but those two groups does exist. And no matter what you do, no matter how you do it, there are people that will say that whatever you do, whatever you say, is 100% right. There are those that will not agree with you, but they support you, and they won't say anything. There are those that will be brave to say, well, Mr. President, I support you, I love you, but this one you said was not correct. What you did was incorrect. There are others who are in that category. And this part, whatever you're doing in terms of how you are contributing to either bring us together or to separate or to put us apart, there are others who will go to you and tell you, Mr. President, what you did yesterday was good. They give you thumbs up. Thank you for calling Mr. Beno, you're a thief. Thank you for referring to him as a killer. They fail to know that those words are very harmful. You shouldn't be saying them. Moruba Moru can say he can go. Free with it, you know, with it. Nobody will have time. We just talk for 2 days. That's it. Jefferson Koji can say it. But you, Mr. President, no. It shouldn't come from you. No, 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 no. No. No matter how angry you are, I was expecting you that day. I heard these people, like we said it last time, when you're taking. You're taking your oath that day to steer the state of affairs for our country. You reminded us that you're not going to be the captain on this boat by speaking good English. But you are going to steer this boat, the wheels of this boat, by actions. By putting developmental agendas together and executing them. That's what you told us. Not the eloquence of your speech. That was brilliant. But you need to start to preach peace in Liberia. You need to live peace in Liberia. You need to encourage us. You need to encourage your people to celebrate peace. You need, you know, you missed the boat yesterday. When we give you the work as ambassador, as peace ambassador for Liberia, you didn't do anything that we can count on today. That yesterday, read in the town or in the city center of Bonga, we had a peace jamboree there. That yes, we went to Nimba. At the stadium there, we had a peace jamboree there. But we went to Bomi County in Tomaburg, and in the midst of the people there, we had a peace symposium there, and we brought people together. No, nothing like that was done. Where did all the money go? As peace ambassador for the Republic of Liberia, those days were being a brilliant day, brilliant time. People felt that you are the best person that can unite the people of Liberia. And many people thought it was true. The UNICEF or the United Nations gave you that responsibility. That's how they also felt. But when these people, these UN people now hearing that this is what you have turned into, it's a big surprise to them. They are in shock. Wow, really? These words are divisive. I mean, this John Brand, he's not all alone. Where he got his wife, or he got his children, or he got some friends, he got extended family, he got supporters. And so the rope is long. You can't say you are holding me or punishing or any punishment you put on me is affecting only me. No. A great generation behind me. Mr. President, you need to change the dimension of the game. You need to change the root of this game. You need to change it. Yeah. Right now, they're going the wrong way. And we can't give ourselves a red card as a nation. You need to come back on the drawing table. Reflect a little bit. Your words should be words that should unite us, that would diffuse tension. Like how things are happening right now in my Gibi County, right? Around 15 gates area. You are the one that should diffuse the tension, especially when they say human life is gone. The process that led to what happened there. There's a ritual. Ritualistic killing. Two of your citizens. Then your citizens decided to come in the street and say, well, nobody paying attention to us. We want to demonstrate. We want to call attention of the authority. If you hear that news, as a leader, talk to the people. If it costs you to take a visit there and leave this market, going to the market people, market women to go meet them and whatsoever. These are places you need to go. There's no confusion in the market. Come on. Where the confusion is, go there, meet the people, sit with them and talk to them. Call them to a meeting. And just sit. How long? How much more should we talk? I mean, how much more? Let me go back to the TRC and just read a couple of paragraphs, and then we take off from here. I'm so sorry that our studio guest couldn't be here. Or let's say he started, but due to network problem, we couldn't go ahead. All right, let's look at a few recommendations here. Recommendations on Accountability, Extraordinary Criminal Tribunal. The TRC hereby recommends the establishment of an extraordinary criminal tribunal for Liberia to try all persons recommended by the TRC for the commission of human rights violations, including violations of international humanitarian law, international human rights law, war crimes, and economic crimes, including but not limited to killing, gang rape, multiple rape, forced recruitment, sexual slavery, forced labor, exposure to deprivation, missing, etc. Nature, jurisdiction, and scope of authority of criminal tribunal. See Article 10 of the Annexed 1, Draft Statute establishing the Extraordinary Criminal Court for Liberia, which is incorporated by reference. Names of those responsible, perpetrators recommended for prosecution. All right, this is it now. Names of those responsible, perpetrators recommended for prosecution. The TRC recommends several persons for prosecution for those human rights violations, including violations of international humanitarian law, international human rights law, war crimes, and egregious domestic laws violations of Liberia and economic crimes. Some perpetrators recommended for prosecution include leaders of warring factions, name and faction, Mr. Charles G. Taylor, MPFL, Prince Y. Johnson, INPFL, Roosevelt Johnson, late Yirimo J. Alhaji G.V. Krumah, Yirimo K., George Bole, LPC, Thomas Yaya Nimle, Model, Sekou Damanti Kone, Lloyd, and Francois Massacre Lett, Lufa Defense Force, LDF. Now, these, according to the TRC, these are the people highly recommended for prosecutions. Names of persons, perpetrators not recommended for prosecution. The TRC recommends that the following persons, though found to be responsible, not be prosecuted because they cooperated with the TRC process, admitted to the crimes committed, and spoke truthfully before the commission, and expressed remorse for their prior actions during the war. But I didn't see Madam Ellen Johnson said it up there. And a woman said she didn't pay money to the MPFL. Okay, those names are Eugene Zina Gray, in Mosorado County, Emmett Sando Gray, Mosorado, Alan M. Nicholas, Mosorado. Joseph Bagbo, Grand Bazo County, Moba Sheriff, Bapulu, Papa Bala, Bapulu. These names are names not recommended for prosecution. It continues. Josiah Milton Blaye, Joshua Milton Blaye, Mosowado County. That's the guy, I would call him General Botnick. Alfred Swa Deble, Mosowado, Morris A. Patmo, Mosowado, Musa Fofana, Mosowado, Ya Mator, Mosowado County, David Kennedy Vanyan, Mosowado County, Morris Weah, Maryland, Washington Moore, River G, Mohammed Sharif, River G, Wilson Sewaye Granjide. Groji as well. Stephen Jones Granjida, Daniel Seth Sano, Badu's Sako Sano, Bob Kathy Za Riverses, Ama Yulu, Monserrado, Joe Wally, Monserrado, George T. Sengbe, Bomi, Anthony Bale, Bomi, Amos Chie, Bomi, Old Man Musa Pee Wee, Bomi, Felix Washington, Bomi, Adama Johnson, Mike Gibby, Vivian Welly, Nimba, Rufus Mahumu, Lusa Mamu Woyi, Nimba, Gertrude Pajibu, Nimba, Junior Duo J. Bon, J. Nimba, Junior Flomo, Cape Mount, Sando Kazulu, Cape Mount, Philip Wulu, Cape Mount, Thomas Boy, Bloju Boy, Monserrate County, and public sanctions, restrictions, debarment from holding public office. The TRC also recommends that all persons recommended for prosecutions be barred from holding public office for 30 years as a form of public sanction. All those holding elective offices shall continue to the end of their tenure and not be eligible to contest any public office in future. But where are they today? Some of them been there now for how many years? This recommendation consider that holding by elections now will be impracticable in light of the current global financial constraints, for which Liberia is no exception. However, those holding appointed offices should resign immediately. In the event they fail to resign immediately, all remuneration should be cancelled. But they stay in power, they continue. Witness protection status. Witness protection statute. The TRC recommend the immediate enactment of a comprehensive witness protection statute for the express purpose of securing protection, domestic or external, of witness of the court. And it says here, what's the time now? Okay, 7 more minutes. Recommendation on accountability domestic criminal prosecutions. The TRC recommends that certain individuals who committed egregious violations against the generality of the population, but such crimes are lesser than gross violations, those persons at the discretion of the prosecutor, the Ministry of Justice shall be prosecutor under jurisdiction of appropriate domestic courts already existing. Names of persons, perpetrators not recommended for prosecution. The TRC also recommends that all persons recommended for prosecution be barred from holding public office for 30 years. And that's the same thing they say here. List of persons subject to or recommended for public sanctions. All those associated with former warring factions, their leaders, political decision makers, financiers, organizers, commanders, foot soldiers shall be subject to public sanctions in one form or another. The below comprising of political leaders and financiers of different warring factions is by no means exhaustive. All other persons similarly situated shall be subject to the public sanctions, as herein described above in section 14.2, and specifically barred from holding public offices, elected or appointed, for a period of 30 years. These are the names. Alan Brown Sr., for 30 years you are barred from holding public office. Randall Cooper, Etta Belt Cooper, Duncan McIntosh Gewe, Jackson E. Doe, D. Bob Taylor, D. Nelson, Jan Martin, Clarence Sampson, Baron Tarr, Harry Yuan, Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, Isaac Yenibo, Cabinet Janet, Archie Williams, Tonya King, J. Apollo Swain, Joe Bala, Thomas Zia, Maxwell Cobber, Ignatius Clay, Vamba Connor, Vali Keita, Paul Molba, Eld Mohamed Sharif, Kwame Fofana, that's Kwame Fofana, Aliyu Korsia, I think that's the guy that was arrested in Europe, Abbott S. Toe, Wale Kobo Re, Octavius Walker, Lovelace Superwood, Tom Wuyu, Tanu Mawulo, James Chile, Amos Lincoln, Noah Bodulo, Edward Slanger, Tige Wonti, Mohamed Jomande, Prince Seo, Abbas Kone, Maurice Dolly, Alhaji Seku Fofana, Charles Benny, Moses Jabo, KBK Sando, Kai Fale, Joe Tua, Grace Manor. These are the names. If we have conducted ourselves properly and implemented the TRC, these are the names. Some of them are in government, are staying in government. They were in government, they stay there. A lot of them are in Liberia. Majority of them are still alive. Some of them are very close associated with the power that be today. Some of them are advisors to the president. These are the names. Mr. President, you're sitting down, you're ignoring it. You're sitting on this document. You don't want to make any comments about it. You don't want to promise those innocent souls that you are going to champion their peace. You're sitting. You're not saying anything. You're sitting. You're not doing anything. Why?
writing's not that easy, but Grammarly can help. This.
Oh, Daddy.
Sensei.
What shall we do?
Sensei.
Sensei. Oh, Daddy.
Sensei.
What shall we do?
Sensei.
Sensei. What shall we do?
Tingadi!
Sinzijan! Oh, Daddy!
Sinzijan!
What shall we do?
Tingadi!
Sinzijan! Oh, Daddy! What shall we do?
Tingadi!
Sinzijan! Oh, Daddy!
Sinzijan!
What shall we do?
Tingadi!
Sinzijan! What shall we do?
Tingadi!
Sinzijan!
What shall we do?